going to study about a new topic in your 12th physics, that is magnetism. Okay, so today's topic is magnetism. What is magnetism? It is the branch of physics which deals with the study of magnet and its properties. So magnet is a substance which was first invented or discovered in a small place of Greece, that is known as Magnes. Okay, in that place a soft stone is first discovered, which is known as lodestone, or it can also known as kissing stone, which attracts some substance like iron, steel, nickel. Okay, so where it was first discovered, this stone is known as lodestone or kissing stone, which attracts the substance like iron, steel and nickel. And due to the name of the place, that is, it is a place named as Magnesia, which is a small place in Greek. Okay, so according to the name of the place, the term magnet is coined. So magnet is a stone which is generally made up of an ore of iron, which is oxidized, or generally it is Fe3O4. This ore of iron is known as magnet or natural magnet. Okay, and the first magnet was discovered in a small place of Greece, that is known as Magnesia. And according to the name of the place, the stone is known as magnet. All the magnets we found in nature are ore of what? Iron. Clear? Then, the natural magnets are of irregular shape and size, and they are generally of black colors. Okay, now magnets are divided into two parts. One is natural magnet, and the other one is artificial or man-made magnet. Clear? So there are two types of magnet. One is natural magnet, which we found from the Earth's crust, and the other one is man-made or artificial magnet. Natural magnet is irregular in shape. There is no definite shape of natural magnet, and it has very less strength. But artificial magnets are definite shapes, and high strength. Clear? Natural magnets are irregular shape. That means the natural magnets obtained from the earth are not have a definite shape, and the strength of the natural magnets are very weak. But the artificial magnet or the man-made magnet, those we are developed for our purpose in laboratories, have definite shape and they are very high strength. Depending upon the shape of artificial magnets, there are different types and known as different magnets according to the shape. So shape of the magnets, we have bar magnet, which is like a bar. Horseshoe magnet or a U-shaped magnet, which is like a shoe of a horse. Or spherical magnet. Clear? So these are some artificial magnets and the shape of some artificial magnets. So the magnetic method is basically used for navigation purposes in ships. Clear? So already we discussed about what is magnet and how it is found from the earth core, and then the types of magnet, that is artificial and natural magnet. Now we will discuss some properties of magnets, and our basic discussion will be about only the artificial magnets, because we used the artificial magnet as they have strong strength and very high strength for the working purpose. So properties of magnet. So first property we will discuss that attractive property. What is attractive property? All the magnets attract all magnetic substances like iron, nickel, cobalt. So this property of magnet is known as attractive property. Clear? So the attractive property will be all magnetic substances like iron, cobalt, nickel, steel are attracted by a magnet. This is known as the attractive property of magnet, and it was first found by the Greek here. The attractive property, that magnet attracts all other magnetic substances like iron, nickel, cobalt, steel and etc. And this was first found by the Greek. The next property we will discuss about a magnet is its directive property. So what is directive property? According to this property, if a magnet is suspended freely, that means if we are suspending a bar magnet freely, it will align itself in a particular direction, and that direction is along the geographical north and south at that place. So if I suspended a bar magnet here, and then the bar magnet will align itself in a particular direction, and that direction will depend upon the geographic north and south pole for this place only. If I place this magnetic somewhere else, again it will align itself along the direction of geographic north and south at that place. Clear? So the directive property is a freely suspended bar magnet will align itself along the geographical north-south direction at the place of suspension. This property of a magnet is known as directive property, and it was first discovered by Chinese are fast discover or who fast discovered the directive property of magnet and the attractive property of magnet was fast discovered by Greek. So these are the basic property of a magnet. So if a substance is a magnet, then it must have attractive property and directive property. Clear? The next property, of a magnet is a magnet have two poles. If it is a magnet, then it must have two poles, and the poles are generally known as north pole and south pole. So for a magnet, let it be north pole and it will be south pole. So what is north pole and what is south pole? A magnet have two poles. That is the property of a magnet. That is, and the poles are named as north pole and south pole. What is a north pole and what is a south pole? North pole. It is the pole of a magnet which is directed along geographical north pole. When suspended free, okay, it is the pole of a magnet which is directed along geographical north pole when the magnet is suspended free. When the magnet is suspended free. And similarly, the pole which is along the geographical south is known as south pole. Clear? So a magnet must have two poles, and the poles are named as north pole and south pole. And what is the north pole? It is the pole of a magnet which is directed along the geographical north pole when the magnet is suspended freely. And similarly, the pole which is directed along the geographical south pole when the magnet is suspended freely is known as south pole. Clear? Now we have to know what is the a pole of a magnet. So pole of a magnet means what? A magnetic pole. Generally, it is the near endmost. Generally, it is the endmost point. Of a magnet. Where the strength of magnetic attraction or repulsion is more. Here, generally it is the endmost point of a magnet where the strength of magnetic attraction or repulsion is more. That means if it is a magnet, then the pole are the region which are nearly about the endmost point. And here, the strength of attraction or repulsion by this magnet towards other magnet or magnetic substances is more. These points are known as pole of a magnet. We already know there are two poles let it be north and it will be south. And how which one will be north and which one will be south? We already know how to determine if we surrender this magnet freely. Which end will be directed along geographical north? That will be the north pole of the magnet. And which end will be directed along geographical south? That will be the south pole of the magnet. Clear? So, the pole is the endmost point of a magnet where the magnetic attraction or repulsion is more or strong. As we already discussed that a magnet has two poles. So, depending upon the pole, the magnet can attract or repel. So, we have to remember that two similar poles. Repel each other. Similar pole means north, north or south, south. Two similar types of poles repel each other. That means if here is a magnet and this is the north pole and this is the south pole and I will draw another magnet and this is the south pole of the magnet and this is the north pole of the magnet. Then there are two south poles. Then there will be repulsion. Similarly, if we draw two north poles close to each other, then there are also repulsion between these two magnets. Clear? So two similar poles repel each other. You have to remember, and this is also similar with the electrostatic. We already discussed that two similar charges repel each other. And next, two dissimilar poles. Attract each other. That means north south or south north. Pole attract each other. Similarly, there are two magnets, is serving north and south, and we draw another magnet here is the north pole and south pole, then there will be attraction. And same case will be happening if we have north and south, and here we have south and north. So similar poles repel each other, dissimilar poles attract each other. You have to remember this property for magnet. Next, for testing a magnet, whether a given substance is a magnet or not, as we know, a magnet can attract or repel another magnet. Okay, a magnet can attract or repel another magnet, but a magnet can only attract other magnetic substances. Like cobalt, nickel, iron, etc. So if we supply with two substances, both are looking similar, one of it is magnet and another one is a magnetic substance. So how we will determine whether which one is magnet or which one is magnetic substance? So as we know, a magnet can attract or repel another magnet. If both the substances are given as magnet, then they can attract each other. And if one of them is magnet and one of them is magnetic substance, then also they can attract each other. But if we, for imagine this is a magnet and this is a magnetic substance, but we are not sure which one is magnet, which one is magnetic substance. If we brought these two close to each other, then magnet will attract the magnetic substance. Similarly, if this is a magnet and this is also a magnet and we brought these two close to each other, then they will attract each other if this pole is south and this pole is north. But if we turn this and it is a magnet and we again brought these two close to each other, then it will be the north pole and it will be the south pole of the magnet, north pole of the magnet. So they will repel each other. This is only happen when these two are magnetic magnets. But if one of them is magnet and one of them is magnetic substance, then by turning these there will be no effect. They will attract each other. So for testing a magnet, the true test is for repulsion, because a magnet can attract a magnetic substance from all of its points. But when there is two magnets, they can repel or they can attract, and the repulsion will only take place between two magnets. A magnetic substance and a magnet can never repel each other. Clear? So for testing a magnet, the true test of magnetization is repulsion. Clear? You have to remember this. True test of magnet is repulsion, because in case of attraction, a magnet can also attract another magnet and magnetic substance. So we cannot easily distinguish between a magnet and a magnetic substance. Here, so for true test of magnetization, repulsion is the best test to determine whether it is a magnet or not. The next property is, what is magnetic length or length of a magnet? If it is magnetic length, if it is a magnet, it has two lengths. One, the zygomatic length, that is the actual length of the magnet from end to end. This is known as zygomatic length. But we already discussed that the magnetic poles are the nearmost, the endmost points, but they are not the end points. They are clearly at the end of the magnet, but not at actually end of the magnet. So if these two are the north pole and south pole of the bar magnet, which are nearly or close to the ends of the magnet, then what is magnetic length? The distance between the two poles of the magnet. Clear? Geographical length is the actual length of the magnet, but magnetic length means the distance between the two poles of the magnet. So magnetic length, it is the distance between two poles of a magnet, and it is generally 85% of geometrical length. Or we can say 6/7 part of the geometrical length. Clear? Next, what is magnetic axis? So what is magnetic axis? If it is a magnet and here is the north pole and here is the south pole, the line which passes through north pole and south pole is known as magnetic axis. So this is the magnetic axis. Here the line which passes through north pole and south pole, or both the poles of the magnet, is known as magnetic axis. Then magnetic meridian. What is magnetic meridian? It is a vertical plane which is passing through the magnetic axis. Okay, if it is the magnetic axis and we pass a vertical plate like this, if this is the magnet and here is the north pole and here is the south pole, then the axis which is passing through this is known as magnetic axis and here is a vertical plate which is passing through it, then it is known as magnetic meridian. The vertical plane that passes through the axis of the magnet is known as magnetic meridian. Clear? The vertical plane which pass through magnetic axis is called magnetic meridian. Okay, next. There is no monopole exist in nature. What do you mean by monopole? We already discussed that the magnet has two poles, one is north pole and another one is south pole. But is there any single north pole or any single south pole exist? No, we don't have any single north pole or south pole in nature. Whenever we have to try to get a single north or south, then there will be a opposite pole come with itself. Clear? That means if here is north pole and here is south pole and we have to cut from here to get a north pole and or we have to cut this magnet from here to get the south pole, then automatically from here, this is the north pole. When we cut it from here, here will be a south pole. And if we cut the magnet from here it is a south pole, and automatically we get a north pole from here. So there is no monopole exist in nature, practically. But for some purposes in later, we imagine a monopole or a unit. Okay. Next, now we will discuss what is the neutral point for a magnet. Generally, it is the region of the body of a magnet if it is a magnet. We already discussed the near about two ends. The strength of attraction and repulsion is very high, and these two points are known as the poles of the magnet, or we name them as north pole and south pole. Similarly, what is neutral point? It is the region on the body of a magnet where the attraction and repulsion strength is very weak or nearly about zero, and it is basically constant at the center of a magnet. Okay, so neutral point is the region of a bar magnet where the strength of the magnet is tends to zero. So neutral point, it is the region of a magnet where the magnetic strength of attraction and repulsion is negligible, or we can say it tends to zero, and generally it is nearly about at the center of a bar. Okay. So we will now discuss what is the pole strength for a magnet. It is the strength of the pole or the force applied by the poles of a magnet to attract other magnetic substances. Here, the force with which a magnet, if it is a magnet, and it has two poles, we know as there is north pole and south pole, and here is a magnetic substance. It will be the iron disc. So the force with which this north pole attracts this iron disc towards itself, or the south pole attracts this iron disc towards itself, that strength of the force depends upon what? Pole strength. Here, so pole strength is what? The force with which a magnet attracts some other magnetic substances towards its health is known as the pole strength of a magnet. So this is all about the property of magnets. What is magnetic pole? What is magnetic axis? What is the magnetic meridian? What is the pole strength? What are the poles of a magnet? And how similar poles repel and opposite poles or dissimilar poles attract each other? We already discussed about all these things. Now we will discuss the Coulomb's law of magnetostatics. Similarly as that of we discussed in the electrostatics, here we will also discuss the Coulomb's law for magnetostatics. It's Coulomb's law of magnetostatic. If there are two poles, here is a pole of strength M1 and here it is another pole of strength M2, and the separation between these two poles is R, and the strength of these two poles are M1 and M2, then according to Coulomb's law, the force of attraction or repulsion between these two poles, if these two poles are similar to each other, that means this one is north and this one is also north, but the strength of these poles are different. The strength of this one is M1 and strength of this pole is M2. Then there are two similar poles, then according to the property of magnet, two similar poles repel each other, then the force between these two poles will be repulsive in nature. But if these two are dissimilar, that means this one is north and this one is south, and they have pole strength accordingly M1 and M2, then the force will be attractive. So Coulomb proposed that when there are two poles of some strength, like M1 and M2, are separated by some distance r, then the force of attraction or repulsion will, depending upon the nature of the poles, will be how much? So according to Coulomb, the force of attraction will be directly proportional to the product of the strength of both the poles and inversely proportional to the square of separation between both the poles. If they are similar in nature, the force will be repulsive. If they are dissimilar or opposite in nature, the force will be attractive. But the magnitude of the force will depend upon how much? It is directly proportional to the product of the both poles' strength and inversely proportional to the square of separation between both the poles. So let it be equation 1 and it will be equation 2. So from 1 and 2 we can write the force is directly proportional to M1 M2 by R square, or this can be written as A equal to some constant of proportionality K into M1 into M2 by R square. Here the K will be how much? Mu naught by 4 pi into M1 M2 by R square for AI. Here, if these two poles are present in a medium, that is air, then the force of attraction and repulsion will be this much. Where mu naught is known as what? Or nearly of air. In electrostatics, we already did similar with the electrostatic. Where the electrostatic force is given as how much? 1 by 4 pi epsilon of Q1 Q2 by R square square. Here is a charge Q1 and here is a charge Q2 and the separation between them is R. And if they are placed in air medium, then the formula for electrostatic force of attraction and repulsion will be this much, where epsilon naught is known as what? Permittivity of this medium. But here, mu naught is known as what? Permeability of the medium. And here the force of attraction and repulsion is inversely proportional to the permittivity of the medium. That means if permittivity is more, the force of attraction will be less. But here the force of attraction and repulsion is directly proportional to the permeability of the medium. That means if permeability is more, the force of attraction and repulsion between the two poles will be more. And for air, okay, where mu naught is the permeability of air medium. And its value will be 4 pi into 10 to the minus 7. Okay, and the unit will be how much? Your 4 pi is constant, F half unit Newton, R half unit meter square, and for pole, you have to remember, we will discuss it later, that pole's length half unit ampere meter. Here, you have to remember this one. We will discuss how much pole strength of unit ampere meter. We will discuss everything in that way. But for this a place, you have to just remember that the pole strength of unit ampere meter. So, what is the unit of mu naught? F has unit meter, R has unit meter square. So, meter square divided by, there are two pole strength. So, pole strength square, that means divided by ampere meter square. Here, so mu naught is the permittivity of air medium, which is value of 4 pi into 10 to the minus 7 Newton meter square divided by ampere meter whole square. So it can be written as 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7 Newton per ampere square. Here, this is the value of what? Permeability of air medium. And this is the expression for Coulomb's force for magnetostatic. And we can also write this formula in terms of vector form also. That is, we already discussed about it in electrostatic. In vector form, we can write it as mu naught by 4 pi m1 m2 by r vector mod q into r vector. Where r vector is the position vector or the vector which defines the displacement or the separation between both the poles. Clear? So this is all about Coulomb's law in magnetostatic. And we will discuss some other concepts or beyond this concept in next lecture.